Everybody makes mistakes in Fortnite. Hey, after all, we are human, right? With how much there is to keep up with a single game, mistakes just happen. And believe me, I'm the first one to admit, I've made so many, many mistakes. But there are some mistakes that we just see too often, right? Those that are so impactful that they can actually be the deciding factor behind a loss. So the goal is just to capitalize on your mistakes and learn from them. Yo, what's up, guys? This is your guy. That's right, your friend. That's right, Keith Allen. And make sure to connect with me on my Instagram. I just want to inspire you guys, man, to just be the best that you can be, that nothing is too impossible if you really just put your mind to it and get your grind on and get your practice on. I want to encourage you today. Lift up your spirits, my friends, and stop being so hard on yourself. You can do it. Have that positive mindset because that's what's going to take you far. That's how you're going to be successful. All right, so moving on. So in this video today, we're gonna be looking at another 5 mistakes we see players commonly making in Fortnite. Not every one of these mistakes may apply to you, or who knows, maybe they all do. But these blunders are so common, guys, that countless players just make them, even in high-level matches. These apply for both competitive and casual play, so knowing about them, hey, it's only gonna help you no matter how you play. Okay, so before we get started, ProGuys has a small announcement to make. We are adding a ton of new features to our site, exclusive guide and analysis videos for our pro members. Also, Pro Pass now grants access to all games. We also have more free coaching passes and points for InstaPro if you're a pro member. So head on over to ProGuys by clicking the link in the description below. All right, my friends, it's time to get this party started. Let's do this. So the first mistake we see happen to a lot of players, and this was my biggest problem, is that they hold on to resources that they should just use. You know, we often see them get into tough situations where they should be using what they have at their disposal to get to safety, but they instead decide to hold on to their items and materials thinking, hey, I could just survive it another way. And it usually doesn't work out and they end up paying the ultimate price, which is getting eliminated. My goodness, how's that happened to you? Even though those things are more useful, if you could just hold on to them for the in-game rotations, there's just no point in just trying to save them if you're just gonna die right then and there. So back before it got vaulted, the Rift to Go was the most common item that many had this bad habit with. In competitive modes, it was just much better if you could just save it for the end game. It was basically a free rotation in those really, really tough final zones. So players would just try to hold on to them so they could just use them for end game, right? Even in scenarios where their lives were at risk. Nowadays, however, Rifts are vaulted, but the same applies to other items still in the game, like shockwave grenades, launch pads, and whatever other consumables that are going to be added in the future. You shouldn't be afraid to use them, guys, to just escape from a sticky situation. The worst thing that you can do is die with the resources still available, which is the worst feeling in the world. We get that players sometimes just forget about what they have, so always try to be aware of what's in your inventory as you run around. Keep reminding yourself that you have a launch pad in your inventory, and you need to use it. That applies to big materials also, especially during the end game. Most of you guys know how to build well enough that you could just probably keep yourselves alive for a long time. You shouldn't be afraid of just playing for placement if you have the mats. That's what they're there for, right? So often we see players have a ton of material in the end game, but they instead go for a 50-50 fight and end up dying. Some players say that if you die with materials still available, you've just made a mistake. Yeah. Obviously, that doesn't apply to every single scenario, but with how effective building can be at keeping you alive, it's not an entirely wrong philosophy. So start building yourself out of those scenarios. The next mistake, my friends, on our list has to do with not controlling structures. Whether they're turtling or in a build battle, players often don't go for control of the structures they should. Getting control of builds is one of the most important aspects that can define the outcome of any fight. And it's a really good sign that you're a good player. By controlling structures, you're giving yourself the ability to edit them while at the same time denying your opponent the chance to do the same. In build battles, it's one of the top ways to successfully end fights quickly. You always want to be trying to place your structures near your opponent to cut them off and create an opening for the kill. Okay, so watch any top creative build fighter, all right, and you're gonna understand this. They do this nonstop. Those guys are so good at using their builds to set up eliminations for themselves, whether it's a cone and a floor to block a ramp push or getting their own wall down next to their opponent. Top build battlers are so good at this. They place structures where their opponents are going well in advance. But builders who are on the lower end of the skill spectrum struggle to even react to structure placement that's gonna help them immediately. So a common variation of this mistake we see some people make while on the defensive end is not putting a cone or ramp inside their 1x1. Having one of those pieces inside your base, hey, it adds a second line of defense should your wall be taken, right? Even if it hasn't been taken yet, you need one down in case it does. Really good box fighters will take your wall and place their own ramp for control before you even know what happened. Then you're not going to be able to place your own, and they're going to edit on you for the kill. Even the floor piece below you has to be controlled to avoid getting trap killed nowadays. That's a piece that most players forget about. You can think your ramp is still protecting you, but if they put a trap at your feet, it can really be hard to avoid falling into it. One final area that players make this mistake with is when they're trying to take an opponent's wall. In a box fighting scenario, okay, check it out. You ideally want to control every piece around you before you start whacking at a guy's wall. That prevents them from editing out and placing traps around you. You can go for a quick wall replace without building first if you like, but just make sure you're placing a cone or a ramp before you hit their wall, all right? That's gonna prevent them from just easily ramping you off. These big errors having to do with structure control can be the difference between living and dying in a bunch of different scenarios. It's what makes the top build battlers so dominant at the game. With how much of an impact the right piece can have, man, it can make all the difference. All right, so next, let's talk about rotating late into the safe zone. One way players commonly die in the early game is when they attempt to rotate within the last minute or 30 seconds before the storm reaches them. Oh my goodness, huge issue. The problem is that other players are likely to do the same, which means that you've got a greater chance to just run into somebody. Then all it takes is just for one player to fire off a shot, and next, your worst nightmare, a storm fight. That is literally your worst nightmare. It is treacherous. You rarely want to take a fight in the storm because of how long they could potentially last. Even if you don't die, you're taking unnecessary damage and setting yourself behind. All right, now who has been there? It's just horrible. You're gonna have to use more resources, right? Like heals and mobility just to make it out safely. Then you still have to worry about the next zone, which might still be a long distance away. And if you do find yourself barely trailing ahead of the storm and you spot another player, okay guys, for the life of yourselves, please don't shoot at them. It's just better just to focus on your rotation and make it to the safe zone first. I know we want these kills, but I'm telling you, patience. So just think about it, an equally matched fight can last at least a couple minutes, so you don't really have the time to get into engagements outside the eye of the storm. Sure, okay, you can start a storm fight, but you're basically hoping at that point that they're a much worse player than you, all right, let's be real, or else it's not going to end quick and it's going to be bad. You know, in competitive matches, this matters a ton. With more players likely to be alive, you really need to be on the ball with your positioning if you want to make it to the end game, all right? That's the goal, guys, making it to the end game. You can avoid storm fights and awkward run-ins by just rotating a little bit earlier than you normally would. Don't feel that you need to loot every chest in your landing spot, all right? I know it's tempting, but you could just find chests and material elsewhere, all right? What's more important is for you to make it to the safe zone and just keep moving. Fights are just likely to occur on the edges of the zone as others rotate in, so don't remain there unless you're just looking for a fight. Instead, hey, why don't you try this? Try prioritizing the center of the zone and use the storm scout to see future zones when you can. This mistake mostly applies to like early game zones where you have a lot of distance to travel, right? If it's a competitive end game, rotating late can actually be beneficial. Since so many players are just packed into the safe zones already, sometimes you don't want to be the first one to rotate. If you do, you might end up getting focused by the whole lobby. That's not a good thing. In those scenarios, it could be better just to wait for the storm to move first. That way, nearby enemies will be preoccupied with rotating themselves, so you're much less likely to get focused. All right, guys, so up next, oh my goodness, blaming the game for your losses. You know, a large reason why so many players struggle to get better, all right, if you want to know the truth, is because they don't critically evaluate themselves when they lose. Instead, they default to blaming their losses for other reasons. Things like thinking you died because an item is overpowered, right? Come on. Or because you didn't have the right weapon. Obviously, things can be overpowered, and I know, bad RNG can occur, but you have to see past that. You need to look at what can be controlled, and that is, my friends, your own gameplay, all right? If you're gonna make excuses, I'm telling you, you're not gonna go that far. So you gotta own up for your mistakes, watch your own gameplay, and get better and better and better. That's how you improve. So here's a common early game scenario that happens a lot, all right? So say you died because your opponent had a shotgun while you didn't, all right? That is a bad feeling, I cannot lie. Complaining about the RNG, though, doesn't really help you improve, though, right? You should instead think about what could have easily been done in your favor, right? Like, you could have maybe played more passively until you found more equipment, or you could have even rotated out and looted somewhere else. You could have taken the fight, but tried keeping your distance so that their shotgun had less effect. Maybe it was a bad drop that just ruined how much loot you got. So guys, regardless of what the mistakes were, there are so many factors at play with each and every scenario, right? The results are as simple as they won because they had a better weapon, or they won because I got spammed by grenades. That may be true for the way it was played, but that's not the mentality you want to have. All right, instead, here's what I want you to think about. How could have I played this differently to have different results? I mean, think about this. If all you do is blame external factors beyond your control, you're never ever going to see areas you can improve in. So guys, remember that you're the one constant control factor across all the games you play. There is always an area you can improve in, whether it's aiming, building, editing, or even just more game sense. So instead of making excuses, let's own up and let's get better. All right, guys, so this is super important. The last mistake isn't specific to Fortnite, really, but it does apply to games in general and with just mindset, even in other parts of life as well. I say this on my Insta, all right? I want to encourage you guys, if you start getting mad because of your losses, it's just going to be very likely to just start affecting your performance for the rest of the gaming session. Getting distracted with your anger doesn't help you play at all. It just actually makes it worse. And I know because I got a temper too, and I got to control that as well. But our brains can't focus on more than one thing without sacrificing some awareness. If you immediately hop into the next game, still just fuming, right, about your previous loss, it's going to start messing with your ability to pay attention to the current match. It'll make you less likely to notice and react to things happening in the game and can cause you to play irrationally, not thinking straight. Then you'll probably die and get mad again and again and again, creating a vicious cycle of tilt. And from there, it's just not going to get any better. Another thing that I always say to you guys when you message me on my Insta is just remember, it's just a game. It is just a game. And I understand a lot of us have a real passion for it, which is great. It's amazing. But you want to use that passion in a very positive way. All right. And that's what's going to help you improve. We know that controlling anger isn't something that everyone can just do easily. So our advice is just to take breaks every single time you have a tilting loss, all right? Even 5 or 10 minutes away from the game can be enough time for you just to reset mentally and just go back to the game, all right? Now, don't break anything. Don't throw anything. Maybe watch something on YouTube. Hey, that you could do that. Watch a Pro Guys video like you're doing right now. All I know is queuing up immediately for the next game and wondering why you lost again while you're angry. Okay, then well, that's where the fault lies. You should definitely be taking breaks, especially after you get tilted. Hey guys, once again, this is the one and only your guy, your friend. And I really am your friend, Keith Allen. Make sure to connect with me on my Instagram. Love talking to you guys. Hey, we got some more videos coming out. I just hope you guys enjoyed some of the most common mistakes we're seeing players make. We know that the last two mistakes we went over were pretty general and not entirely specific to the game, but hey, you'd be surprised on how easily those two negative mentalities can affect your Fortnite progress. So let us know in the comments what mistakes you often make as well. All right, guys, we'll see you soon. Peace.